Cell phones off.
Cell phones off.
Silence.
We are rolling. Did you want a beer, Lauren?
Sure.
Very much. They're in that craft pack there.
Does it come with a plastic bag in it like that?
Mm-hmm. It's my own internet brilliance. Yes, I've created a...
That was pretty good, Lauren. Duff bot. Kind of a lighter.
Fruity, aren't they?
A little sweet. So kind of florally. Not bad.
I've had some dog clouds that are so nasty.
Lemonade beer.
Oh, no, that's not right. It should be a...
It's pretty... I mean, it's dark.
Yeah. Yeah.
In color, at least.
Yeah. Okay, we're here. We're back with Ctrl+ART+Del at Ken Yarus and Richie Carter Studio. We're going to talk about the art biz today. Tough topic for artists. So, and that's why we're doing it over a few beers.
Yeah.
This episode is brought to you by the Heart of the West Art Show. Happening in Bozeman at the Grand Tree Inn, August 11th through 13th in Bozeman, Montana, and in Coeur d'Alene, Idaho at the Coeur d'Alene Resort, September 1st through 4th. And Ken and Richie are going to be exhibiting there, and myself, Morgan, and Lauren will be working it and organizing it. So they're about to head over to a big show in Great Falls this next week.
Mm-hmm.
So it's the start of the show season in some ways, in March. And we're here. So
excellent. Yeah, it's already looking busier and busier. Talking about we're not painting this time because I've been spending so much time this last week just doing business that it's hard to really switch into that other type of your brain. To go from such a concrete, very, I guess like paintings are calculated, but not like businesses. It's not as dry and stark. Like you really can express more, think more emotionally, and with business that really sabotages you, I think. So
it's actually harder, I think, to go from the business back into the art part of it,
mm-hmm.
for me at least. Like it's easy to take the break from painting, you know, and then just start doing, you know, what you need to get the show ready, but
right
the other way around.
Is it because it's almost easier to have like a list of tasks with its business side? You just have a list of tasks and you try to check one off at a time, whereas with art there's so much possibility and so many decisions to be made. Do you think that is part of why it's harder to switch that way?
Yeah, I think for me, I mean, I doing the business thing, it's more like this task. It's just, like you said, it's just this checklist, and it's not as much of my mental capacity doing it.
Mm-hmm.
And so painting is, for me, you know, it's much harder. It's much more, you know, it's all my mind going into it. It's like you said, there's so many different possibilities, so many ways your brain's thinking, whereas business, I can just turn to this mode where you're just like, okay, get this done. It's, you just have to put in the time. It's not as much, I mean, it's effort too, definitely, but it's not the same kind of effort.
Right.
If that makes sense.
As mental.
As painting is for me.
Absolutely. Yeah. So I guess the history of the art business probably began with Egyptians, maybe? I'm guessing here. But as far as...
somebody was being sold. Yeah.
But, like, patrons. That was the model. That was the business model in the beginning.
Yeah, well, free somebody, market in general wasn't really a thing.
Right.
Government was still so much more involved. I mean, government, not really, like, or the church.
Right.
I think
church,
a lot of, like,
that's huge.
The artistic heritage, Western art heritage, anyway.
Yeah,
it's
the
church basically created it all.
That's true.
But this new type, it's all free market based, I guess, is just really wild. Kind of glad we're able to have this studio here on my parents' property because of basically the patron model. They are excited to propose to be supports for us and make it a thing. But for artists without that, and you're on your own, just begging the free market to be there for you, it's a serious gamble.
Mm.
Yeah.
And it keeps a lot of people from, I think, continuing it.
Yeah, and I think we're at a place right now where it's changing drastically just with all the online stuff. You know, it's like we're starting to see more of the fine art stuff move towards this online world, if you will, and it's, I don't quite even understand it completely, and because it's kind of just in that process of evolving into it.
Mm-hmm. It's going to be a lot more transparent.
Yeah.
Everything, all the prices.
Oh, yeah. Exactly.
All of that's going to be a lot more. Right now, they seem to limit it by requiring, you know, you have to buy an account as a dealer or something to be part of AskArt. But it's open to anybody. Mm-hmm. Anybody willing to pay the subscription is for the like top third of kind of artists, I would say there's going to be results on there from auctions and things. They have a track record built up.
This is the online stuff you're talking about?
Yeah, I've done some of the appraisal tools like AskArt.com.
Oh, sorry,
ArtNet, I think it's called. Artsy is a new one. And they all do slightly different things, but big ones, they all essentially, you can look an artist up by their last name, first name, and it'll show you their auction results for the last 20 years, 30 years maybe. And that's how appraisers generally get their information about pricing, is by comparables.
So that's on the investor level.
Yeah,
more or less.
The more of the blue chip artist, but I mean, established artists generally are on there. If they have a web presence, if they've been in a lot of auctions, museum auctions or otherwise, it depends on whether the organization decides to upload that information,
right?
Share that information. So, and that's a decision that auction houses make. Are they with? I don't know if they do it by the auction necessarily. We just don't share our results with those sites because some artists have an issue with their pieces going for lower than their retail value, and it can then affect. And it's a certainly valid concern. I believe Frank Cotton works this way. He prefers a pass to a low sale in an auction, and that all has to do with reserves. You know, the minimum bid that the piece has to reach in an auction. But I could go on for about auctions for a while.
That's been your kind of specialty.
It kind of has, yeah. It's an inexact science. It's not a science, I guess. It's more of an art.
It seems a lot like more like magic.
Well, there's three parts. I think it's first you find high quality artists, and then you attract with prices that you believe the market will support, essentially. And then the third part is getting collectors to come and people who are able to afford to buy.
From your standpoint of putting on these shows and auctions, what is maybe some of the more challenging aspects within those three?
Yeah, well, it's more and more crowded every year, I would say. And then with the online part, in addition, making everything more transparent, and these new sites are doing an auction a day or something, and it sort of eliminates what I think the galleries might be concerned about, and auction houses. Is that it eliminates the middleman of the art. It's allows artists to sell more directly.
So that competition is something you've been...
We don't really, I mean, it's such a huge industry. It's you know, many tens of billions a year, I think, the global art market. And it's hard to measure, you know, our results against somebody else's. We're doing kind of a unique thing, which is mostly working just with living artists, living work. And a lot of auction houses the bigger name ones pursue the consignment stuff, somebody's estate. They go after the most high quality pieces, the Sotheby's or Christie's, and they'll get those because they have the brand that allows them to be everywhere. Somebody says, oh, I have this nice piece, maybe it should go to Christie's or something. And they've been around for hundreds hundreds of years, I think. Whereas we're just trying to help artists sell their work to their collectors, and but yeah, the online portion has grown. I think the first time we had something on, like, the actual live auction online, it sold one piece to an online buyer, and then this last one we sold 7 or 8 to online buyers.
So 700 times.
Yeah.
Improvement.
1,000% growth or something, but we'll see. I think it's a trend that'll continue. Well, that said, it's crazy to me that these people are buying this work sight unseen.
On the internet. Without having actually seen it in person. Mm-hmm. So that's such a huge part. For me, if I can sell something online, that's great, but for me to experience a painting, like, I wanna see that right up front, see the quality of it.
Yeah.
But I mean, that's,
but if you have an artist's work in your collection already,
and
you've seen the photo, you're familiar enough, and that seemed to be the profile of the people that we mostly sold to, is that they had collected before. They see this person comes up and for auction, they're in Florida or wherever, and they get online and bid.
That's cool.
It is.
And you can reach anybody anywhere. It's like,
you can approve bidders basically by saying, like, well, oh, you're from China. I don't know if I want to ship to China.
Yeah.
Or, like, I don't know if I trust that person. So you can pretty much, like, they have rating systems for every bidder and a history and things. So
that's cool.
You can kind of judge whether or not. So, like, we'd accept, like, Canadians and North Americans basically, I guess. But anywhere else, starts to become more risk of a scam or
something.
Do you ever get those emails from people saying they want to purchase your work from, like, Europe or something, and it's a very complicated payments system?
Yeah, and I've heard people on Facebook, I follow a lot of different artists on Facebook, I've seen them post a lot about that, and sometimes it's hilarious, just even the grammar that they use.
Yeah.
Like, well, obviously he's not a collector, but I've only had one email like that, and I just deleted it right away. It was some place in New York saying they wanted to have a great show with all my paintings. It's like,
the pay-to-play places?
Yeah,
I had one of those contacting
me. It's like, yeah, I don't know what to do.
Vanity shows, they call them.
Yeah,
maybe.
God, I just decided it was some kind of scam. But it does happen quite a bit. I can imagine somebody falling for it, but...
What I'm talking about is people who are trying to essentially have artwork sent before they pay for it.
Yeah, that's
right. Then I'm not sure what the game is after that. Like, whether they expect to resell it or... they ask, like, well, I'm in this country, I have this cousin in New York, and they'll set up this account in the Western Union or whatever.
Oh, yeah.
Classic
Craigslist.
Mm-hmm. But then there's also those... that sounded more like what you're talking about, is like a vanity show where they, you pay to play, you have your work featured in this really nice book that they make, and
well, they said it was gonna be a gallery, I didn't even. They said they just, like, oh, we love all of your paintings. It seemed like it was like generic, like cut and paste, like they found an email with fine art on it and blasted it to people to see who would bite their little money laundering thing. I don't know.
All you need is one, I guess.
Yeah, that's true. Get some sweet old lady. She's excited about her cat pictures, and she's done for.
Yep.
Hmm. And I think one of the most interesting parts about this, and for us to be able to talk about it, is that we're all quite young within this art market.
Experienced.
And I mean, every time I do a show, I'm just, like, learning so much about, like, okay, how do you talk to collectors? How do you, deal with gallery representation or just all that stuff that it's like, yeah, you, I mean, for me, I'm really learning it as I go. Mm-hmm. And I would have loved to have, like, a class or something where, like, you have gallery managers or whatever representation come in and speak to you about, okay, what is it really like in the art world, and in your particular field. I mean, it can be so broad in that, but just to tell you what it's like when you go out into the real world, you know?
And what gallery managers are looking for.
Yeah, like what are they looking for? And I had one course that was actually really good with that. It's called Professional Practices. So we had to build a website. It was mandatory, and I still use, you know, that website. It does need to be updated pretty bad right now.
Studio Online or whatever. Is that FASO?
We just could use any web hosting, yeah. So, I mean, they did that. They, you know, how do you put a gallery packet together to submit work to a gallery? There's some really good stuff about it.
Mm-hmm. And that was at MSU?
Mizzou.
Mizzou,
U of M. That class was really good, but I just, like, to have an even more depth, in-depth, you know, just instruction of, like, you know, talk to real people who are out there, artists,
mm-hmm.
gallery owners, you know, people actually coming.
Because the academic side is sheltered from
that. It's very sheltered, and you get out and you're like, okay, I'm a tiny little minnow out here, and how do I even, and you know,
that was another minnow.
Luckily, I mean, I'm here in the Platte Valley, and I grew up here, and there's a lot of art going on and connections that are, you know, easier to make than, let's say, I just moved to New York and was like, all right, I'm going to be an artist.
Yeah.
I just sink. So connections really help, but it's really just a learning thing for me every time I go into a show, and sometimes I'm like, oh, why did I say that? Oh, that's not the right way to interact with somebody. And I probably think way too much about
like
that.
Like a cocktail party class, where critique each other's small talk at a party.
Oh my God.
That worked.
On that same note, Richie and I listened to an Audible book called Art and Fear. I'm sure it's a regular book too, but it's on Audible. And it's written by David Bales and Ted Orland. And they mention a part of the education system, like if doctors, say, went through their full education or any four-year degree, and within 5 years, only a third of their graduates are employed in that career, they would reassess their educational parameters.
Right.
They would try to figure out why it's not.
Because that's how it is in the art.
And the art world is like that, but there's this extremely huge disconnect between what's taught and what's applicable to business in that regard. It's, I think, coming to a T, hopefully, or ahead of some variety that people will, or, you know, that either programs will see such high dropout rates or failure rates that people, especially with our lower economy, that it'll change and they'll have to reassess what's being taught and why.
But the thing is, they know it's happening too. Because, I mean, when I was in school, they're telling us the statistics. All right, in 4 years, I don't know, I'm making this up on the spot, but like 50% of you will not be making art anymore. In 7 years, 25% will still be making art.
Mm-hmm.
And it just keeps dropping. And I'm just like, I mean, they're telling us this. And it's like, okay, well, why is that happening? I mean, it's multifaceted, you know, it's not an easy world. It's not an easy thing to be creating all the time and putting yourself out there.
Well, people don't absolutely need art.
Yeah, it depends.
They don't need art to live.
They need to thrive, I think. They don't need it to survive. They need it to be...
Whereas healthcare or fire or something, you need to be put out if you're on fire.
Yeah.
You pay pretty well.
it's not a requirement for the economy to function or for... He wants to be okay, but and that's a huge part, but I feel like being trained in a way that completely negates some of the more problematic aspects of the career you're choosing is crazy. It just seems crazy. And that's why I didn't go to regular college.
Yeah, I mean, it seems to me like the answer is just like, it's hard, and just go out and try. It doesn't seem like many... I'm
practical.
Just kind of thinking about it, but no one's really spent time to be like, okay, well, why? How can it be?
Or what are those 25% who are still doing
it?
Yeah,
what are they doing?
What is it?
Yeah, to study that all, but I think that'd be interesting, but yeah.
Well, it is so multifaceted that each artist is only so much responsible for their success. Because relationships are so huge. If you can't make those relationships, even if you're very talented or any of these other things, you won't really carry forward, I don't think, because it's so based off of that. Any of the shows I've been in so far, which I'm in the younger stage of this whole thing, but still, it's because you know somebody, they know somebody, they talk to somebody, they like you, ultimately.
Yep.
I don't know how much business I could have done that could have made it better or worse, but I know there's definitely things you can do to be better, too, so I'm still trying to figure it out.
Lauren, what did you kind of experience? Because we both got our BFAs. And so I'm just kind of curious how you kind of experienced the education on it. If they...
I did an additional program for my course where we did like professional development.
Yeah.
All that, but yeah, I don't know what. Do you mean afterwards?
Yeah. Well, did you feel like you were prepared?
Yeah.
Business wise, even. I mean, like, it's like you learn how to.
I mean, I still feel like I'm not at the place that you guys are at. I feel like my work is kind of at an embryonic stage right now. I'm hesitant to like introduce it to the influence of like business and the pressure of like
the market.
Yeah, the market. And
yeah, it's terrifying.
Mm. Yeah.
And like this. How does that affect you guys? Like, your work, does it affect it at all?
I paint a lot more fish than I probably would have.
Like, what you choose to paint or what you, like,
yeah.
Submit painting?
I mean, my experience with it, so, exactly a year ago, I came into kind of this world, kind of just hopped into it. That's one that we're kind of speaking of now by going to the Out West Art Show at the Heritage and Great Falls for the Western Art Week. And, you know, I had talked to Ken, who had been in it for multiple years before that, and some other artists who were involved with the Russell auction and all that. And I was like, yeah, this would be something to get into. And so I kind of jumped in, not really knowing at all what it was going to be like. And then, you know, I just had some work that I was like, yeah, I like some of these paintings. And it was pretty overwhelming for me. I didn't really know what to expect, but I just saw that whole business market, you know, who do you know? I know it was all just kind of bombarded on me, and I didn't react very well to it. I didn't take it on very well or handle it. And so I had to do some pretty big reassessing of how I was thinking about this art world and how I wanted to paint and what I wanted to paint for. And then, and I really came to this Great Falls show like, okay, I hear you can sell work, you know, I'd love to get my name out there, sell some stuff, you know, see if I actually can make a living on this, and which includes the business side of it.
Yeah.
And I feel like I painted kind of for the wrong reason in a sense. But being at the show, I realized the caliber of work. And so I was like, okay, I'm gonna step it up. And then I went into the Coeur d'Alene show that Morgan runs, at the Heart of the West at the resort in Coeur d'Alene in, was it August?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, August. And I painted all those paintings in this new mind frame. I was like, okay, I'm gonna really just paint what I want,
mm-hmm.
and what I'm passionate about, and I'm gonna go into this, and I'm not gonna have the mindset of having to sell them all or sell art even. I just want to paint them for people to enjoy, because I feel like that's what art should, I mean, it's for someone else to have an experience with it. It's not, I don't ever want to paint just for the money of it, you know?
Yeah.
And I painted, and I was like, all right, bring these pieces I'm really proud of, and I ended up selling a number of them, and it was a really good show for me. And it was just my perspective that shifted and my reason for painting. And so even now I'm just like, I just want to create quality work that I'm passionate about. And like you said, you're always going to be painting something that you're like, all right, I'm getting a paycheck for this. And that's totally great.
Commissions.
Commissions, whatever it is. But for me, I really just want to keep it first and foremost about what am I passionate about? Because if I'm not passionate about it, it's not going to show through the art. And people who are just looking at that don't even know me, they can tell the difference. It's pretty crazy. I really experienced that. And so that's kind of where I'm at. And I mean, I've been selling a few pieces and I'm liking what I'm painting, and I'm not just pigeonholing myself into, I have to do this to make money. And like I said, I'm at the very beginning of it, so I don't have as much at stake, you know?
Yeah.
As maybe,
well,
somebody who's very...
Well, if you think about it, if you ever let what's at stake wash over you, you're not gonna get much done at all.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
I don't know.
Career path that
I know how easily like influenced that can be. Just,
mm-hmm.
Like even with Instagram, I used to be kind of like, I would post everything on my own. I could see how I mean, I used to have like almost 2,000 or 3,000 people or whatever, and that just like all these people I don't know how their
reaction is to it. Yeah,
is, like, was guiding me, and that was.
I think that's
I
a really
feel like I was like pandering to the conventionality or something to try to like get more.
And you were painting toward that?
Yeah, and I was like frightening to me. So
do you have a? Can you think of like a specific example of a piece where you
just like painting?
You would paint more of what was reacted to more
like,
on social media.
I would do like sketches of like people, like famous people or something. And those would get like tons of likes and stuff.
Right,
and
right.
That's all I want to paint.
They were really good. I saw a few on there.
like they were really good.
But,
they were really good.
Yeah, I
I hear you though.
But if that's not truly you and what you,
and, yeah,
you're
I feel
interested
like
in.
Like, something I'm trying to find or something I'm trying to say that if I let that influence me at this point right now, I don't know where.
No, I completely understand. Like, I just got an Instagram, and I've already noticed that feeling kind of starting.
Like people that you respect, what they...
Yeah. But I think, and it's so immediate with Instagram. It's like, you can put it up, and these people anywhere in the world are like, I like, or they comment on it, and so you have all this input coming so directly and quickly, and I really think that that's, it's very easy to be influenced by that.
Yeah.
And I completely understand. It's a weird pressure to have on, because no one else in the history of the world has ever had it in that sense.
Okay,
if you want. I don't care, that's a doppelbock.
Yeah.
All you have it.
Sick.
Yeah, I don't know. That whole...
It's very interesting.
See, I have... are you
starting? No, you go for it. Yeah.
I sold some stuff early on, which was for me like... like you talked about, the validation is huge. It's like, what likes are one thing when you get like $1,000? Which doesn't seem like maybe a lot in the great fine art world, but to me, it was just insane.
Yeah.
The encouragement you get from that is cool, but it is short-lived, and so I found out that I painted one painting that sold, and then got pressure from various like places that said, you need to keep doing that, make another one. But it's not, art isn't always something you just make another one of, and really started to feel the struggle aesthetically, because it really wasn't me, it was just practice painting.
Yeah.
And I came to this place where you paint, so certain times it, you know, strikes you better, the pose is better, the lighting's better, and you make it happen, but it doesn't mean that's who you're going to paint, what you're going to paint forever. It's not really coming from that internal place.
Yeah.
It's coming really from an external, observational place. And that pressure I started getting became way too much, and I had to actually say, like, I'm not going to do that anymore and paint what I wanted to. But like Richie, you said, I switched from doing that and then sold better. Was a lot more comfortable making paintings, which the quality went up, and the quantity went up. So you're able to make more paintings when you're really feeling it.
Yeah.
And it's the more you can stand out on that ledge a little bit, it's, I think, again, the problem with it being a free market thing is that's not always the freedom people are given. And when you have an opportunity, especially as young artists, where we can play around, they were living here, it doesn't cost us a whole lot, so we're able to get away with experimentation.
Which is so important, I think. It's like, when you stop, like, experimenting and trying new things, it's like, you might as well just
failing,
stop.
Yeah.
And failing, yeah.
Yep.
So trying to keep it fresh for yourself is going to make it fresh for the viewer, and I think in our day and age where it is so immediate, it's not like people get to see your work once a year. They can log on your website and see what you're doing. They can look at your Instagram and see what you're doing. And if they don't see some kind of growth or thought, really, we're like, I guess I've had this kind of, maybe it's a romantic notion, but the people that are buying paintings live in a completely different world than we do. They have money, they have assets, they have a very comfortable, concrete existence in that regard. I know a lot of their investors, but like, we're living on this edge where we have no money in our bank account. We're experimenting with all kinds of crazy ideas and ways of living that I think on some level has to be entertaining to them or exciting to them. I mean, it's I always say to them, but really it seems like such a different world. I've never experienced it. I've never...
Because a lot of those people are doing a 9-to-5, and they can count on that paycheck, and they know they can pay their mortgage, and and you're out of here hustling.
Yeah.
I think there's a lot of, like, mystique surrounding artists.
Oh, yeah.
So if you switch it and be a businessman, I feel like you're going to lose that mystique on some level. Like, you might just be that, man. They might like you more because they'll get along with you more because you'll be on the same page, maybe, but I don't know. I feel like it is something that artists offer to the world, is that alternative.
Yeah.
Like, they want to walk into your studio and see, like, this crazy environment and, like, paintings everywhere and, like, paint all over the walls and just, like...
Yeah.
Or see that you are trying stuff. Yeah, that you are doing something that they weren't prepared for. Like, they're used to a world that's fully prepared. Business is about preparation. And if so many people are doing that, an artist, it's really so much of... If I came to every painting totally prepared, then all my paintings would have already always looked the same. I'm as good as I always will be.
Yeah.
And that's really interesting too, because it's like, yeah, you can't do that going into your paintings, but then when you get to the business side, like we've been doing for the last 2 weeks, getting ready
you better
show,
be prepared.
It's like you just spend those that I marathon time that I don't like do it sporadically. I just like all right, it's go time for a week, and it's like you have to be prepared. So you show up to a show, and you appear as if you're so prepared, but every artist knows that that's not.
So what are some of those things we've been doing?
Well, one of the things that, you know, we made our own pre-show, I guess, to this big Western Art Week to show our work to our
community.
It is Friday, March 11th. So in 2 days, from 6 to 9, get this up real quick, Mark. 6 to 9 at a really cool old ballroom above Sassafras. It's a shop downtown Kalispell. So we're gonna have a cool show with me, Richie Carter, that is, Ken Yarus, and Nate Closson from Whitefish. We're gonna just exhibit our work for 3 hours just to our local community, and anybody's invited.
It's a great idea, because a lot of people from the Flathead Valley come over
to the
out west, Western Art Week in general in Great Falls. So
So hopefully it'll be a good. So we're preparing for that.
A little hype.
Yeah, and I mean it's a lot of work to put something on, you know, your own small show, but it's also you're in control of everything and you have a lot of investment into it, and I love that part of it. It's really fun to have that more intimate time with the people coming to view your art, but that includes, you know, getting photos taken of your work after it's done, you know, varnishing all your pieces, getting framing figured out, ordering frames, price tags, we're just doing that right now, labels, getting advertisement out, we've done that in a couple newspapers, you know, and all the social medias, Facebook and Instagram, kind of, you know, little spurts of that leading up to the show. Logistics of how to, you know, when we go to Great Falls, how do you get there with, you know, 20 paintings and panels if you have to have them in lighting, and keeping up on your payments, which
getting rental tables for the lighting still.
Yeah, getting table. I mean, there's just so much into it that I was actually talking with my buddy from California who's a business guy. He started his own clothing company down there, and he's now moving on to other things, but he was like, wow, that's like, I never would have like thought about all this stuff that you are doing and going into, you know, it's for us on the outside, it's just like, oh yeah, you just paint and then something magical happens and the hangs are gone and you have money. But he's like, oh wow, there's actually, like, that's really cool to see, you know, all that goes into it. It's a lot of work.
And tears.
Yeah. So.
And it's upfront money. That's a big thing I think people don't.
Right.
Like,
yeah.
There's... And I guess if you like gambling, you could try fine art.
I know there's a lot of people in this country that like gambling. So
yeah.
Listen up.
Yeah. You guys
just buy some art.
You would love this. No, not even buy it. Just make it and try
or
to sell
it.
I mean,
it's a gamble for everything.
Any of these shows you go into with, I mean, for me, I pay for a framer here locally, Framer Reference, Derek, who does an awesome work. And it's not free. And so I will go into a show with at least $1,000 of framing on paintings that I pay for beforehand with credit. If I sell them, amazing. Yeah. Usually one painting will cover that bill, and I can be rest assured, thankful, grateful. I have those frames. They are really an investment for me because they are quality. But when you go to pay that bill without money in the bank and then hope it sells,
Cash flow is a real problem.
It's really business. Not something. Again, if it was a big business and I could say, yes, I could make this back, then your gamble's gone. But the gamble is there. And I had to bite that bullet before, where you go to the show, sell nothing, and walk away with money on the credit card that you will then scramble the next few months just to deal with. Mm-hmm. And I think living in that, like you said, the possibilities and the fear will keep you paralyzed from actually making risks. But, you know, that's a part of the gamble of the art world. You can make risks, I feel like. If you really got to learn to sit it out through that risk and just wait and see. And usually it's worked out so far. I've been able to recoup costs, but every year it seems like I'm kind of in the red, just chugging through and making sure it's more about presenting good art. It's fun to do this show because I'm able to be in control of it with Richie. Like, we're tag-teaming it to make it something that we both are excited about. Mm-hmm. And when you're working with a gallery or show, we surrender that. And I couldn't put the work that you guys do into it. So it's nice to do something small and local, but when it comes to those bigger stuff, I think you do have to bite the bullet and pay the fees and just let other people do it because they're better at it.
My mom has two full-time people working to get her work out there and prepare for these kind of shows and things, and that's something she's lucky enough to be able to afford to do, but most artists can't. And that is a big barrier to getting that traction with your work, because you're focusing not all your energy, but too much energy on the business side of it. So
that, like, you know, you're saying your mom has a couple people working for her. Just since, you know, October that me and Ken have been sharing the studio, it's not like Ken's working for me, I'm working for him, but we kind of just collaborate, and that is also a huge change from just a year ago of going into the show. Yeah. Like, we, you know, we can set up a list and be like, okay, we need to get this done and this done, and we can, you know, keep each other accountable for things. And so, like, all this business stuff that we've been doing for the shows hasn't been daunting or anything, because we're just like, all right, what are we gonna do today? Well, let's make a list.
Yeah, accountability buddies.
I like that. So that's been really cool on the business side, but then as well as the creating side, it's been, and I didn't really expect, I didn't have an idea of what it would really be like, but it's been.
We both still spelled words wrong on our email newsletter.
I'm not going to talk about what words they were, but there were some mistakes.
You're more visual, people. Mm-hmm. Textual. Yeah.
Which goes back to that paying somebody.
I one time forgot how to spell. When I was living in France, I like tried to block out all English and I forgot how to spell couch. I was asking guys, like, wait, how do you spell couch? I want to spell it with a W and it wasn't C-O-W-C-H. Yeah.
So could we talk about pricing a little bit?
Ooh, yeah.
How do you do it? Okay.
Well, I was very fortunate to be mentored in that by Steve Cawdrey. You're familiar with him. He really broke that down for me a lot when I was really young. I was in high school, and he gave a talk on business of art, which is when you're talking about education stuff.
Yeah.
The first time I even heard somebody mention it, really, it's just a mystical land that people knew about and no one really talked about. But he really took some of that stuff and simplified it down to nice things to understand. But at the end of the thing, I had a show at the Lahock Day Museum where he was giving the talk at, and I asked him what he thought about this painting, which he said he would buy. I had no preparations for that whatsoever, so of course I sold it for $20, and he said he would have paid triple that, which for me was just like mind-blowing. Yeah, it's like, so, wow, like, that's, looking back on it, now getting a painting for $60, you know, it's still not pretty good.
Yeah, he made it like a bandit.
And Steve likes to do that, which is why he's a great businessman, but for me, it's always a learning curve to be around him even and to see the tenacity. But he really introduced me to pricing your work based off of square inch and trying to read there's still a lot of mysticism to it, I guess, to me. Like, with where you're selling, good. You know, so if you set your price point, look at other people, comparable painters, look at the market, whatever you can do when you're starting, which I did then, but the market's changed considerably, and trying to gauge how it should climb, when it should climb. And I've talked to various other artists about it too, and it's like, you get into a big gallery show somewhere, you get into a magazine cover, say, raise your prices, right? I knew somebody that they got into a gallery show, and they raised their prices by, it was a lot, it was a significant jump. So maybe a third, they jumped it up, and they sold nothing.
Yeah.
At like a premier gallery show. And
gamble.
Again, maybe people looked at their pricing on one of these art market, these investor-level websites, and said, wow, this price has just spiked, and they're not willing to trust that, or I don't know what goes into it, really, on that buying level, but I know when people, when they're informed, as they hopefully will be, you know, it can help you out, but pricing your art is just always going to be difficult, and the more people you can have opinions on, I think artists will sometimes be really sheltered about it, and I try not to be. I like to ask as many people as I can, like other gallery people. I talk with Derek quite a bit, and Steve still, and ask them what they think about these pricing. Does it seem fine? And I'm trying to just increase very slowly, but with the market as it is right now, I probably will not be doing a lot of increasing this year until things start to sell, and then I can say, okay, we're getting to another gallery, getting to another show. But yeah, I definitely price off square inch, and basically the smaller the square inch, the more the price is, and as it gets more square inches per piece, the price per square inch drops. But you want to make sure that there's not real math to it, but you really kind of gauge it as it's climbing up. You have your top range and your bottom range, and you're going to work within that price per square inch. So it's nice to have kind of a number you're looking at that's really clean, and you just, as it goes up per square inch, some people price off the actual image, but you're going to be all over the place.
Well, yeah, I mean, that square inch thing, you kind of told me about that, and that has freed me up, at least in this topic, so much to not have to really worry. Like, I mean, sometimes, you know, I'll do a huge piece and it happens really quick and I'm happy with it, and then other times it takes months and weeks or whatever. And so, you know, that old, I guess the old way of thinking is like,
and sometimes that quick one might
was
be
better.
Much better.
Exactly. That's usually the case. And so it's like, you know, my old way of thinking is, okay, it took me longer, I can charge more, but at where I'm at, and you know, being an emerging artist, it's like, I can't be like, oh, I really like this one and it took me longer, so this 16x20 is gonna be more than this 2x2 foot one or whatever, you know. And so
the whole hourly rate,
no, hourly
does not,
it doesn't,
the industrial revolution's hourly wage does not apply
to painting
art.
No,
in any way.
So,
that was the number one question, not number one, but very frequent question that my mom would get, not much anymore, but still at shows and things, is how long did this take you to do? Because they're trying to calculate what your hourly wage was. And it just breaks down. It doesn't work that way. Her answer was like 60 years, essentially,
your
age.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's the answer.
You're a highly trained individual making something that takes hours.
They don't get that. So here we are to educate, hopefully.
Every painting you ever did was a result of the one before it.
Yeah.
And if you think that this one is worth less, sorry, bud, it wasn't me. I mean, everything you do is a growth. But yeah, it is. I'm glad I don't get asked very much about that. I feel like that would be frustrating. But yeah, I mean, I guess I get it more from people that aren't educated about the art world, maybe because they've already asked those questions, but like, so some of my buddies will just, that'd be the first thing they ask, like, that's a great painting, man, I love it, like, how long did it take you?
Yeah, that's the first question.
Yeah, it's like anybody that's not, so I try to educate them, I guess, without being rude, but, you know, let them know, it's like, oh yeah, this is, maybe I did this in 2 hours, it's like, wow, how much you get for that? I will never know, I'm gambling, dude. Just like, the guy, I will probably get nothing for this. Or yeah, I'll spend $200 on the frame and then make nothing. So they don't really get that. And a lot of people, they're used to doing something for their time and getting money.
I always have the topic come up, you know, someone might be interested, you know, it could be a friend or something, and or someone's parents or whatever, someone is interested in a piece or a commission, and they're just super stoked about you emailing with them, and it always comes to the price issue, and they want to know, okay, well, how much is it? And the, you're like, okay, well, I always tell them, like, you know, I've sold enough pieces that I can say, well, this is what I sell this size for. And then never fails. That's the end of the conversation. They don't even write back.
Yeah.
And it's literally like, you know, if, especially if I know the person, I'm like, if you're interested in my work, I'll work with you to make it happen.
Yeah.
I would love for you to have a piece.
Or something.
I just want them to have a piece if they really like it. That's the biggest thing. But it's like, I don't know how to, there's always this awkward place where, I mean, you know, people who aren't familiar with how much art can be and that.
It's just not affordable to the average person.
It's not.
It's a 5%
payment plan
thing.
Is,
I mean,
interesting though. That's, I've never even thought about that before. We're trying to offer that to people that say, like, yeah, I would be so stoked to have $20 a month that
was
coming in.
I just wouldn't ever get a payment. I've done that with things and people.
Yeah, it's
3 years later. Dude, you owe me $20. Come on, seriously. I don't even want to ask you for $20, but just on principle, I am. So give it to me.
Or I'll take it.
That happened, yeah.
Like a high school sketch or something.
Oh, it was when I used to build longboards, skateboards.
Wow.
I'd press them in, like, do all the design work,
cool.
And then I would, you know, just deal with these people. I'm like, yeah, dude, I'll pay you.
Well, they're skaters.
I was like,
I
was way too nice. I was like, yeah, you need this to, you know, have fun on and ride around on. You pay me next month, and then 3 years later, like, all right, I need my $20.
Just take your longboard back.
Just push them off, grab it back,
break
them down. Yeah, break a few bones.
Mossy style.
My mom does that. My dad offers like. Nancy Cawdrey, he offers payment plans if somebody really can't live without something, you know, and he's had people who paid $50 a month for a couple years, and they'll miss like a few payments, but for the most part, they've never had any issues, so it can work.
Yeah,
it's one model.
Let's deal with those higher price points, because I feel like there is, and maybe it's more of just a weird economy happening right now, but the hands and the cookie jar ratio is getting bad, is my observation. It seems like there's a lot of competition.
Too many hands in your...
Yeah, so there's maybe, I don't know how many collectors there are, but that's the cookie jar. And there's a lot of super, super qualified artists all trying, all just living. And you look about, maybe the top 5% people you're talking about are into the deceased art, the stuff that's really... investment level collecting. A lot of Richie, you are it's hard to say that we're investment level collecting at this point. Mm-hmm. We don't have enough. Like, we're, if you look at the statistics, the next 5 years or whatever, we're going to be not doing it. So then investing in us would be difficult. It's like investing in some African country. They're probably all going to be dead soon. Who knows? But no, you know. But it's like the investment levels come from that like reliable income. Good investing is just like they want that, but.
Yeah,
maybe they start gambling, they'll take us younger artists, but you've done with a younger, it's a more varied collector, so it kind of freaks me out. To
see, and that, like, for me, I'm like, okay, if I was at a place where I was buying art, and I saw something, you know, I actually knew what I was looking at, and I saw something that I was like, whoa, like, I'm not saying that my work is that, but I'm like, you know, if I saw some young person that was like, and I really like their stuff, I'd be like, oh, I'd be so excited by their work rather than some established person.
But if you could buy a John Singer Sargent or your work.
Well, that's just, of course I'd buy a John
Singer. Yeah, see, that's the problem.
But if I was buying a John Singer Sargent, I could afford to buy some, like, emerging artist, young person's work. It'd be like it'd be like going out for a blizzard.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, good. Okay, I guess I can spend $3.
But that's a cool thing, though, that they're not just buying it for the value of it, like the monetary value. They're actually buying it.
Because they like it.
Because they like it.
Yeah. It makes them.
And they
want to
put it in
feel something.
Which is why I want to sell work. I don't want people to be buying my work just because they think it's me worth something someday. Because.
No, that's not a good way to approach.
These collectors with, like, warehouses just filled with priceless pieces of art that no one ever gets to see. And they don't even, like...
Well, I talked to... when I was going to school at the Grand Central Academy of Art in New York, I... Like, various talks they gave, or they had... I was able to meet with Peter Trippi, who was the... Or I think he still is the editor of Fine Art Connoisseur, and another gentleman that runs, or helps run the Salamandi Club in New York City, also named Tim Newton. Both...
What's the Salamandi Club?
It's this... They have a really, really fantastic, like, lower... I want to say it was Lower East Side. I'm doing my geography right, but they have, like, a really great building that they... The OPA was just recently... Or no, the Art Renewal Center's big award-winning show is the... It just came through there. They do big art shows, and I think it's kind of like a...
Salon,
sort of? Sort of, yeah. They hang it like a salon. They just fill it with art. They do really great realism-based work, which is... I mean, I'm in that weird niche market, I guess. But for the East Coast, they really represent a quality and high level of sophistication with that stuff that's not... I mean, Sotheby's will have that work, but they don't showcase it. It's really just, I don't know, numbers. Like you said, they look at how much... that crow would be worth, and they sell it for that. This, they would collect, they do have a lot of living artists, and they are big proponents for them, and they want to look for that aesthetic, I don't know, perfection, or that pursuit anyway. They last I've seen...
Realism.
Yeah, and they really, or just craftsmanship even, they just will take, they'll take a lot of contemporary styled work. If it's figurative or narrative on some level, it has to still be quality. And as far as more of the complex notions of the club, I don't really know. I have to do more research for it. But they are always hosting really great events. But Tim Newton is one of their... Honestly, he's at least a curator. He helps put on the shows and hang them and everything. And he's a collector himself. And I talked to both those guys about coming to the GCA to talk about business. Because I was so freaked out about it. Yeah, I was like, and they didn't talk about it. The GCA was all about craftsmanship, and they excel at that. But if you ask anybody...
Did you get them to come?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. And so, yeah, I sent them emails or talked to them at one of the little opening parties or something we had, and they came in and gave a talk on it. And I really remember Tim talked about. Yeah, Tim Newton, who's a collector, talked about how he has stuff under his bed. You know, it's like it doesn't deserve to be under there. He wants it to be out. He wants it to be hanging. He loves those paintings. He bought them because he loved them.
Yeah.
And he said that it's sad when he looks at the collector world or the people that are on that high level of investment art buying, they're not buying it because they love it. And
it's just for the numbers.
But he's like, but a large amount of other collectors, especially if they're doing it for something on a almost a moral level, he really went almost to that level, I guess. It's like when you really think about what art is for the human spirit and what it represents in our society, the kind of influence you have, which I don't think collectors necessarily think about, maybe they do, but like by buying someone's work, you're validating everything that they're standing for, all their principles, all their pursuits, and it's a beautiful thing if you see it that way and you encourage it and you spend your money in that way. But he said that that's what a lot of collectors will do, and he strives for that. And he wants to create an art world that, I guess, condones that, which is really... I know, it's really cool. I was really glad you talked about that. And we talked about some other business stuff, but it didn't still get into, like, the brass tacks as much.
Yeah,
it was
kind
of left on that nice,
like,
comfortable business level. So how much would you buy my painting for, Tim?
Well,
I don't love it, so I'm actually not going to buy it. No matter what you price it at.
Did you ever see that... I don't know if they were alive when you were there, but that older... very elderly couple that they did a documentary film about them, and they're two postal workers, and they saved up their whole lives and bought like a bunch of amazing artwork in the kind of 60s and set, just went to all the gallery openings, discovered all the artists before they were big, and amassed this enormous, in a tiny Manhattan apartment, amassed this enormous collection of really high quality work on postal salaries, which, because they didn't spend on anything else.
Well, they were also buying up and coming people, right?
Right. Yeah. Well,
so
they weren't buying, you know, Warhol at now, but
yeah.
They were buying it back then.
I think I remember hearing about them. Yeah. Yeah.
If you can know
what to buy and who at that level, it's like
Yeah, and if you're in you happen to live in the epicenter of one of the most famous like artistic movements in the world.
Yeah, so say out here in the West, I kind of wonder about that. I mean, so say you bought someone's teepee painting 5 years ago or whatever. I mean, the Western art market seems so much more stable that, like, there's wild cards that come in there and all of a sudden people want to buy this particular subject, but they're still generally looking for realism, or maybe they're looking for more colorful stuff now. Mm-hmm. You know, what it's going to be, and we already mentioned it, I guess, about how that affects your aesthetic and your pursuit as an artist really can be dangerous, but as a collector, how you gauge that stuff, if you were going to really do, like, some kind of investment Western art buying stuff, I feel like it'd be really difficult. Like, the Russells are selling for $1 million,
yeah,
but you can't buy one for $50 now, or even $4,000. I mean,
99% of the artwork created doesn't really hold value for the most part.
Yeah,
that's the depressing. That might be a slightly high percent. No, it doesn't hold, like, monetary value. It still holds a lot of intrinsic value to the people who own it, right?
Yeah.
And the people who enjoy it. But, like, the resale market.
Which is why you probably don't see Russell selling for $22 million or whatever the Sotheby's stuff is going out east.
Yeah.
Because it's an entirely different market.
I think just that's a great point. Like, it's so easy, especially, you know, as the creator, to get sucked into, like, the whole just money, you know.
What's gonna sell.
But that's, I mean, that's not,
like, valid.
Yeah. It is an easy whirlpool to just fall into.
Like, measuring your success or your,
yeah,
value,
yeah,
your work on.
Yeah.
Right.
Like, I noticed with, like, a sale, like, before I was, like, you know, getting a sale, I'd be like, oh yeah, okay, now I have that affirmation, I feel better and more confident. And now when I sell something, it's like this, that's awesome, that's great, I love, like, it's kind of this, like,
no more chocolate ramen this week.
Yeah, yeah, but it's not like where my, like, happiness comes from, whereas before that would have really affected, like,
mm-hmm,
if I'm happy or sad or whatever. And it definitely, I'm like, yeah, it's great selling a painting, that's awesome, but it's not where I'm like, if I sold one, I'm happy. If I didn't, I'm not. And it's like a struggle to get through. Uh-oh. I'm just wondering. But, yeah.
Yeah, I think that if I'm happier now finishing a painting that I'm proud of.
Yeah.
That's, and or with these big shows, I feel like I pile work up and hoard it. And once a year, suddenly I get, or twice a year now, I get this big opportunity to put 20 paintings,
yeah,
up. And
that's
see it
pretty
like,
cool.
It's like, wow, this
that's
is
really
cool.
Yeah, and I'm, like I said, I'm happier, like, getting to talk to people who are actually, even if they don't buy a piece, if they're just like, wow, I really love this piece, like, getting just that feedback, that makes me happier than when someone's like, looks at them like, all right, I want that, you know, they did that. Like, I'm actually happier
from the,
than
the thoughtful response.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
And the person,
yeah,
influenced. Yeah, that's a good point. Good way to look at it.
It's maybe easier to say that right now where I, you know, I'm supported.
Yeah, probably whatever.
Our patrons.
But, I mean, it's... I
and
mean,
every artist has to find that some,
yeah,
some
find some
way or another.
Support, so.
And
yeah,
every artist that you're thinking, that you look up to, started hustling somewhere. They had to. And it took them a lot of years, but...
Yeah, I talked to you... you were
too.
The Hockaday, was it opening for the Timeless Legacy show, which was a really great opening with all the female artists of Glacier Park. They're trying to really highlight them. But Russell Chatham came to that opening to support Rusty, which was really, they've got this really cool mentor.
Russell Chatham is a famous Montana, Livingston, Montana artist who does very atmospheric pieces.
Yeah, super great. And he, I had like maybe a brief conversation with him sitting down there, and one of the things he said to me is like, just keep showing up.
Yeah.
And that was the main thing I took away from our conversation, was that like, this art world will go up and down, mm-hmm, and I've already seen that in my like 5 years of painting and being in it, selling stuff, that it's up and down, and the more it's, you just keep showing up. I think that you do it for 20 years, all of your peers, all the people that have been in the art world will just acknowledge you that someone that,
yeah,
is there for it, that you'll be in shows, you'll be invited to stuff.
Like, they can invest,
hoping.
They can count on you.
Right. It's, yeah, like, and it wasn't because I was like, I'm going to pay all my bills with this, I'm going to be super psyched about it. It's that I just kept showing up and painting and working and
spending money, and it, I think we'll...
That's all you can do.
It's
really hard to do that, and a lot of people don't. A lot of wannabe artists can't. They can't get away with it. Maybe they have a child to feed or something.
Yeah, no, totally, yeah.
It requires a certain set of circumstances, basically. It
definitely does.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's the thing. I'm like, I feel pretty lucky the position that I'm in circumstantially, like, you know, not having a kid or a family or whatever. Like, I can afford, I can invest in what I'm doing, you know.
Well, back to the schooling a little bit. When you look at how much tuition is, the dream school I was originally looking at was the Chicago Art Institute, the Art Institute of Chicago. Tuition was going to be somewhere around $40,000 a year.
Yeah.
And that was 2008. No idea what it is now. It's the number three art school in America. Well, I went to their summer program and was asked to paint with my feet because they felt like it would really push me. Which was like, for me, I was like, I'm at this point where I'm trying to learn some of the craftsmanship stuff here. Like, if you aesthetically decide it would be the best thing for your expression to paint with your feet, cool. But don't just tell me to paint with my feet. Because I paint well with my hands, like it blew my mind that they would talk like that, teach like that, even like
charge
encourage that, and they were charging a lot even for the summer program. Mm-hmm. And when I saw how much tuition was going to be, I switched to pursue academies. Mm-hmm. But to do this art world gig with what would have been $120,000 of student debt, absolutely impossible. I mean, it's impossible with almost any job. Everybody that went to architecture school that thankfully got a great job.
But on a gambling career, getting out,
it's like that. If you were to play a game of poker and the buy-in was $120,000 and your chance of winning,
that's crazy.
8%.
Depends on how hard you work.
Anyway, it just I'm really, really thankful that I came out with no student debt.
Yeah,
because the academies were $8,000 a year.
Nice.
With materials, I mean, they're just not. They don't charge it because they're doing it for their reasons. Mm.
Good deal.
Corporate schools are doing it for a whole different game.
Are they a non-profit or something? Or?
A lot of them, well, the academies, the ateliers, they're usually ran by an artist who hires all those other artist buddies that you're paying the $8,000 and just give it up to all of them. So if there's 15 students paying $8,000, they all might make a couple $1,000s. They devote a little bit of time a week, but the real, I guess, I know, the quote we'd always say is you get hours for the powers with this art stuff, I mean, with painting and drawing. The teacher is only going to teach you so much.
Yeah.
Like, hold your pencil this way, or, you know, maybe look for light and shadow in this way. But ultimately, the more your brain is doing it, the better you get at it.
Yeah.
Someone doesn't, they told you, you ride a bicycle by pedaling your feet. Have fun.
They might speed up the process, but you still have to put in the...
Yeah, you got to actually learn how to ride a bicycle.
Yeah.
So think about it and
push
the pedals
around. The worth of it is like, talked about this before, you when you're in school you got to be around other people, you got to have critique and get feedback,
mm-hmm.
which is really priceless.
Yeah,
you know, and then also as the
but if it's $120,000 a year, is it really priceless?
I mean, it's no problem. But then also as the, from the teaching side, like, you know, once you start teaching things, like, you know, you might get a couple $1,000s or whatever out of it, but you gain so much more understanding of your craft when you teach it. I've been teaching a couple classes at the community college, and it's just been really eye-opening in that regard. You know, I'm wanting to focus, you know, primarily on making art at this point, but the whole teaching side has been pretty cool too.
I think it is good to teach.
Yeah.
I think you gain a lot from just...
You put definition to things that you do. You put, like, words to it and, like, a systemized, like, way of thinking about it. Like, oh, yeah, I do this... And why did because of this and it does that, you know. And
it's true.
One other thing I wanted to talk about, like, have you guys ever seen a piece of art, you know, for sale? And I mean, I'm not at a collecting stage at all.
Yeah.
I don't have that
you can trade.
I can trade things. But like, have you ever seen a piece of art and you're like, I mean, I'm thinking of me as someone who has pretty much no money to spend on that. Like, I saw a piece of art, it was at the Hockey Day, and I was like, I want that. Like, I love that piece, and I asked how much it was. They couldn't find the price sheet at that time, but I'm like, I still think about that piece. I won't actually probably buy it, but it's like, I saw this piece, and I don't even know who the artist is, but just the visuals of it, I was like, and it's a very contemporary, it's a ceramic sculpture, but I still have it, like, I can,
it's pretty,
it's like right there in my head, and it was beautiful, but I was actually like, I would consider, if I had a few thousand extra dollars, I think it was around 2,000 maybe,
somewhere around there.
I was like, if I had extra $2,000, like, I would spend it on that rather than buying a ski pass and new skis. Like, I'd actually buy that because I thought it was, I was that, like, you know, into that. I think that's it's kind of reassuring, you know, because it's like, anybody can,
there's worth.
Like, that's what the art is about, to, like, get that connection. And then the money doesn't, it's kind of, it's pretty secondary, you know.
Maybe I should buy it. I just bought like a $100 book that I cannot, like.
Can't. I shouldn't buy it.
Yeah, but I really wanted it.
Was it an art book?
Yeah.
What kind of book was this, Lauren?
Well, sometimes you gotta look at those as an investment.
Yeah,
it's
an investment.
Yeah. That's a lot easier to explain than.
And I bought my friendship one, and I was like, I'm happy. Rice and beans.
Yeah. But no, I think it's. Maybe as an artist, you realize you're like, You realize what that artist, you know, as a fellow artist, what where they're at, maybe, but I mean, there's something to be said about making something that someone's very drawn to.
Yeah.
So regardless of their income.
Risk financial ruin for it.
Yeah. I will be bankrupt. I'll have this amazing sculpture, and then they'll take it away from me.
Just hide it in the basement.
Mm. That's cool. That's why they put it under their bed.
So no one will find it. Yeah, maybe let's all start marketing it, as this is actually an investment to your, not any financial investment, but just
your happiness,
well-being.
Your life, your well-being. Yeah, I mean,
it's part of why I paint landscape. I spend so much time doing like academic drawing of people, and I don't know, I got pretty good at it, I guess, but at the same time, it was like, people are such a drag sometimes, you know? And like, I've never been to Glacier Park and been like, oh, I hated that.
Yeah.
It's not that love pretty. So many aspects of that indefinitely, forever.
That's true.
Even like a stormy day, you'd see some glorious burst of sunlight through it, and I don't know. I just that's what really drew me back to the landscape after doing all the figurative work, and I'm good at figurative work. I could.
Yeah.
That was kind of the stuff I was selling, and like I don't know. Like it just wasn't the pure love that I was.
I think I would get I get more of an emotional reaction to a really well done landscape than I would to a well done portrait or figure, and that's not true across the board, but yeah, more often than not, I think it's when somebody's captured natural beauty perfectly, like there's nothing like it.
Yeah,
it's worth it. Feels good.
Yeah,
feeds the soul is the term that we use. That's the value.
I'd be pretty stressed to be a collector in that regard. I don't think there's enough money that I wouldn't want to spend. Like that.
Well, and like wall space. Like
how
much possible.
You would have to build a wall, a warehouse. I mean, I think a lot of artists would have talked about that. It's like, oh yeah, you could just buy stuff forever.
Well, that's why people fund museums, basically.
It's true, yeah, they have so much that, like, I have a museum amount of work sitting in a warehouse. I can
The
build
Booth
this.
Museum in Georgia is apparently amazing. It was just one of the largest, maybe the largest Western art museum in the country. And just because some wealthy people had a huge collection and loved it and made it happen.
It's pretty cool.
We appreciate it.
Yeah, art should be shared.
Yeah. Absolutely. Well, anything else you guys want to talk about? That was pretty interesting.
Yeah.
I didn't cry or anything. Or scream.
Or swear. We don't have to put an explicit tag on this. Yeah.
Yeah. Good
job.
Dragon's fresh beer.
Cheers.
And we will be back in 2 weeks. Thank you. Right after the guys get back from Western Art Week. We'll check in after that. Maybe not right after.
Yeah,
we're going to talk about this.
Our spirits are good now. We'll see.
Yeah. We'll see you then.
Thanks for the beer, Morgan.
No problem. Good job, guys.
Okay.
Did it.
That was fun. You were talking to friends.
Yeah.
Yeah, Richie, Mr. Red.
Because I wasn't painting. When I paint, I, you know, I, like, Ken starts talking to me, and I'm just like, Uh-huh. Really, what'd you say?